Kevin Anderson, thank you very much, first of all, for taking the time. And also, how are you enjoying your visit to Ireland so far?
I'm really enjoying it. It's hard work. I think I'm probably spending almost all of my time engaging and working, so I'm not getting to see a lot of Ireland, but I'm getting to hear a lot about Ireland from discussion with people in presentations and talks, but I'm not getting to see very much. So I think I'll come back again for a longer spell, perhaps with less work.
Okay, and I suppose you'll have had a good flavour of the landscape with regard to climate change and how Ireland is positioned, both in terms of its recent legislation and also, say, vis-a-vis our targets and so on. Would you have, as an outsider, would you have a view on how Ireland Incorporated is doing with regard to climate change? Are we grasping the nettle?
I think certainly not. I mean, we have to be very clear about this. In relation to what Ireland, of course, has signed up to, and in the recent Paris Agreement, which all nations of the world are signed up to, and particularly when you think Ireland is one of the wealthier countries of the world, it's wealthier per GDP, income per GDP, than the UK, and certainly well above the European average. No, Ireland is not doing what is necessary, anywhere near what is necessary, to deliver the sort of commitments that Ireland has signed up to in the Paris Agreement. And I think it's also fair to say that something similar could be concluded for the UK, for the EU more generally, and probably for many parts of the world. But then you come back and say, well, Ireland is a particularly wealthy nation. It has a wonderful renewable potential, probably as good as the UK's or even Scotland and Wales that I've worked a bit more with, or Norway. So it has that potential. It also has a very educated workforce and broader population. So it has everything it needs, all the wherewithal that's necessary to make the rapid transition to a low carbon energy system, and indeed a much lower carbon agricultural system that would be in line with the Paris Agreement. And at the moment, it is choosing to do very little in that direction.
Right. Many politicians in Ireland and for example, people in the agricultural sector would feel that we're a small country and we've just recovering from recession, so maybe this isn't a good time to deal with climate change. Maybe it's something we can deal with in 10 or 20 years' time. What would you say to that view?
Well, it completely misunderstands the science. The one thing we're very clear about is that the temperature rise that we are already seeing, and that we are going to be seeing increasing levels of temperature increase across the century, and in fact even just across the next few decades, that it's the emissions that we put into the atmosphere now that really matters. So though you often get a focus on things like 2030 or 2050, what really matters from a scientific perspective in relation to temperature is the total quantity of carbon dioxide we put in the atmosphere, what we call the carbon budget. So the emissions that go out into the atmosphere today and tomorrow and the day after, these are really important. They build up every single day in the atmosphere. So it completely misunderstands the science to think that we can hold back until some period in the future when we expect to be a wealthier country able to resolve these problems. That misunderstands, and I would argue to some extent deliberately misunderstands, the science underpinning climate change. And then the next part is, well, Ireland is a small part of the problem. Well, every part of the world is a small part of the problem. We hear this from every sector. The aviation sector says this, the shipping sector says that, the UK has said this. You go to Beijing and Shanghai, you add those two together, its emissions are only quite small relative to the same size as the UK. So is Germany, California, again, only 2% of global emissions. So you can divide 100% of all emissions into any small numbers you want to. Using that as an argument is really very false and, again, very misleading. So I would not expect an educated population like Ireland to be making that sort of argument.
Okay. A large portion of our emissions in Ireland are attributable directly to the agriculture sector. Mm. And as you may have heard, under Food Harvest 2020 and Foodwise 2025, the government has undertaken a really large-scale expansion of our ruminant-based agriculture. And their argument is that we can do it more efficiently, for example, than the Brazilians clearing rainforest to produce beef and to produce dairy products. Is that a reasonable argument from you, with your scientific hat on?
From a climate change perspective, it clearly is not a reasonable argument, and I'm sure that anyone who's making it is aware of the science can see that very clearly. You cannot hold those arguments and meet the commitments that we've signed up to in Paris. The other thing I would say, and it's really important, not just for agriculture but for energy, the area that I'm more commonly engaged in, the climate does not care about efficiency. It has no interest in efficiency. It only cares about absolute levels of emissions. So if you're going to look at Ireland, then you have to look at what are the absolute levels of emissions. Now you might then start to say, well, if Ireland is providing food to other parts of the world through export, then it needs to be making sure that food is provided as efficiently as possible, assuming therefore that it's not going to be in addition to emissions from other parts of the world. So it will be substituting, say, for poor levels of agriculture elsewhere. But if that is the case, then I think measuring efficiency in terms of carbon dioxide per kilogram of beef or carbon dioxide per ton of milk or whatever it is you sell, I gather it's milk and beef are the two big issues,
yeah.
Then that's not the appropriate way to think about this. If we are really concerned about feeding the world, then you measure it in terms of nutrition or you measure it in terms of calories. So what are the CO2 per useful calorie that you produce? Now that will almost certainly mean you have to move away from the types of agriculture you have now that are innately very high greenhouse gas emissions, have innately high, very high greenhouse gas emissions. You have to move away from that to other forms of agriculture that have much lower emissions of greenhouse gas gases per useful output of calorie or per useful unit of nutrition. So I think the forms of measures that you're using today are, again, inappropriate and misleading.
A meteorologist, an Irish meteorologist, Professor Ray Bates, has argued on national television in a recent debate that while he fully accepts that climate change is real and that it's occurring, that in his opinion, it is in no way serious enough to be described as a global emergency, and certainly not enough that the Irish agriculture sector should take it into consideration, for example, that it should curtail its beef and dairy expansion. His view is that the Irish national good is more important in the short term, in the medium term, than climate change, which we will deal with further down the road. And he quotes, if you like, low-range IPCC projections, as he would see them, to defend this view. Would you have a view on that take on the science?
If he's following the broad framing of the IPCC, which is innately a conservative process, and that's rightly a conservative process, that's how science evolves, then his view is legitimate, but only at one end of the extreme. You then have to say, so he takes an extreme view that we are unlikely to see significant levels of climate change with current levels of emissions. Other scientists, and many more scientists, would take a view that we are likely to see very significant levels of climate change. So provided they're all within the sort of scientific framing of these issues, it is then the role of the public, of civil society, of the policy makers to decide, what's my attitude towards risk? I have one person here saying, I think it will be at the lower end of the increase in temperature and the set of impacts. And you have many, many more scientists who are equally well qualified arguing, we think it will be considerably higher. And then this becomes a risk issue. Now, if you were looking at this as a betting person, you think, well, where would I put my money? Most experts think actually it's going to be a much larger climate change signal relative to our emissions. And one expert thinks it's going to be at the lower end of that spectrum. And it's up to us to decide. Part of what feeds into that would seem to me would say, well, what are we applying this risk to? We're applying it to our globe, to our planet, to the place that we all live, that 7.3 million people, billion people rather, live today. And it would seem to me very foolish to take that risk that one expert, relatively one lone expert, is right and all of the others are wrong. So I think it would be a foolish mistake to go down the let's keep our fingers crossed, let's hope that climate sensitivity, as we call it, is at the lower end of the spectrum, despite the fact by far and away the majority of scientists thinks it's more likely to be at the middle to the upper end of the climate sensitivity range. Yes, we do come across that very regularly, and often people, I'm not saying that's the case here, I mean I don't know this person, so you know, I'll be very careful about what I say there, but we often hear people sort of masquerading as drawing conclusions from the science when really they're making much more politically expedient comments, but they're trying to legitimize their view on the premise of some sort of fairly dodgy reading of the science. Now, I'm not saying that's the case here. But of course, if you make the argument that we accept the science, but we think actually the amount of damage, the impacts are going to be relatively small and the rise in temperature is small, that's an attractive message. I mean, we all want to hear that. I want to hear that. The politicians want to hear that. The public wants to hear that. We don't want to have to change our lives because of climate change. So I wish that was a view that I held and could share from the science. I and the majority of people who look at issues of climate change think that view is an outside view, and we are very much more likely to see significant levels of climate change, and that will have very significant impacts on our lives if we choose not to act. And of course, if we do choose to act, that will also impact our lives. But one of them we have some control over by reducing our emissions in a controlled fashion, and the other we have no control over. If we await the impacts that, of course, many poor parts of the world are already seeing from climate change, if we keep waiting for those, then we're going to have very significant impacts imposed upon us by nature, by physics, by the climate.
Okay. We're 3 months, Kevin, since the Paris Agreement. You were there, you attended, and I think many people seem to have come away thinking, well, that's the climate sorted anyway,
yes,
and now it's time,
yeah,
to move on. We've all heard, of course, about the INDCs, which I understand are really voluntary commitments made,
yes,
by governments. And my understanding is that they would amount to, if fully implemented by all 195 governments, would amount to about 2.7 degree centigrade increase at one level, which I should add is well outside the safety range. But I do understand that you believe that even that figure is doesn't tell the whole story. Could you elaborate on that?
Yes. So what's happened is that all nations, or virtually all nations around the globe, submitted these pledges, these INDCs, into Paris. So this is what these nations think they will be able to deliver in terms of reducing or changing the rate of growth of their emissions, but basically between 2020 and 2030. So it's a very short time frame we're talking about. Now, not all countries had different sets of units or different dates and so forth, but there was quite a lot of different baselines. Some were absolute emission reductions, some were relative to the size of the economy or related to population size. So there were different ways that these pledges were framed quantitatively. So it is then the job of the scientific community to take this slightly messy bunch of data and sort of say, well, how does that look like it's going to play out into the future? Now, firstly, all of these pledges finish in 2030. So given that we're talking about temperature later on in the century, you have to make some estimates of what we think will happen post 2030. Now, if you're fairly optimistic about these things, you might say, well, actually, let's imagine that there's a considerably larger increase in effort towards reducing our emissions after 2030. Now, if you do that, then you can sort of say, well, it doesn't seem too unreasonable that we could be heading towards post 2030 towards a 2.7 temperature degree centigrade temperature rise. If, however, you sort of say, well, let's imagine they carry on with roughly the sort of same level of effort that they've already spoken about, what would that look like? And that looks much more well over 3 towards 3.5 degrees C temperature rise, which is a very significant increase over 2.7, which is already a very significant increase over the 2 degrees C that we agreed to in Paris. And actually, remember, in Paris we also agreed to 1.5 degrees C, and that's because for the poorer parts of the world, they feel that even at 1.5 degrees C, the level of impacts are very significant, as at 2 degrees C, they see them as very destructive, if not deadly, to their societies.
Yeah, many people were surprised to hear the phrase 1.5 mentioned at Paris,
yes,
given that there had been a view that that ship, so to speak, had already sailed. Would you have a view as regards the location of that ship?
Well, it's almost reached its destination. The current emissions into the atmosphere of carbon dioxide from energy are about 36 billion tonnes if you think of all per year. If you think of all the carbon dioxide emissions put into the atmosphere, then they were 40 billion tonnes. In the next few years, we will have used up all of what we call the carbon budget, the total amount of carbon dioxide that we can put into the atmosphere for a 1.5 degree C temperature rise, according to the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change best estimates.
How soon, Kevin, are we talking about?
Well, we are talking probably within 5 to 8 years, we will have used up all of that budget. So by the time we get back to review our pledges, by that time it will be too late for this ship that has set sail. So it set sail some time ago, and it's just looking to dock.
Okay.
In its 1.5 degree C port right now.
So 1.5 in Paris really was rhetorical?
It was rhetorical. It was there in many respects as a sop to the poorer parts of the world, which I think was, well, disingenuous at best.
On disingenuous, earlier in the week I heard you describe or speak around the subject of whether or not some of your scientific colleagues are involved, if you like, in self-censoring about the reality of the what the science is saying, and particularly how they communicate that to policymakers, to politicians. Could you elaborate?
Yes. Many of us who work on climate change, our conclusions beg fundamental questions about how we have framed our modern society. You know, the whole concept of economic growth, of progress, all of the things that have served us very well in modern society. The problem we have now is that our climate change science says that if we want to hold this sort of 2 degrees C temperature framework And bear in mind that is a huge change in temperature, and it's going to occur very rapidly indeed. If we're going to hold to that sort of temperature framework, then that cannot be aligned with the current sort of economic paradigm that we have, which is one that we must always see increased material growth, that the whole of society must progress and be measured in terms of this material well-being. We can't reconcile those two. You cannot have the way that we've been growing our economies be matched with the commitments that we have made in relation to this 2 degrees C temperature threshold. And so therefore, as scientists, it's hard for us to say that, because if we say that, we're making what would seem to be a political message. Now, I think it's just a political implication of our science, but you are then having to engage in this political realm. It's also challenging because it's difficult for those of us who work in this area. We want to see positive messages. We want to live a positive life, a good life. And yet this starts to beg questions about those of us who are relatively high emitters. And of course, most of us in science, the scientific community, are in that particular elite group of high emitters. We don't want to have to change our lives. The idea we like flying to our conferences to meet colleagues and friends elsewhere, that we like to live good lives with our families and take regular holidays and so forth. That the way we have normalized our life as relatively high emitting elite is, again, that is questioned by our own science. So you can sort of see at every level, whether it's a personal level, whether it's a professional level, it's actually very difficult to speak out about what our conclusions are finding. And we also know that I think what we've seen really in the last 20 years is how strong and dominant the economic paradigm has become. So in fact, I think it would be fair to say that quite a few of us who work more on the basis of sort of the science and the physics, that we have run scared of questioning the economics. And I always try to point out that we've had physics for about 13 or so billion years since the Big Bang, and it's been very, very successful in describing the world. And we've had the current economic framework for really just a few decades at most with this obsession with growth, and that is already starting to come up against the buffers. And yet somehow we think that this ephemeral growth paradigm is more important than our understanding of fundamental physics, and we have run scared of questioning that paradigm.
And you think scientists are involved in that deception, and I use the phrase advisedly, that perhaps unintentional deception, because we still hear a lot about greening the economy and green growth. Can we replace the brown economy, Kevin, with a green economy and continue on the growth model while maintaining the possibility or entertaining the possibility of a world below 2 degrees?
No, I think the answer is a categorical no on that at the aggregate level. But I think the detail is really quite important there. As I said before, the lion's share of emissions come from a relatively small percentage of the population. 50% of global emissions come from only 10% of the global population. Now, that doesn't just mean the people in the wealthy countries. It also means a significant number of people in China. Probably 300 million people in China emit like the average European. But then a billion of them, of course, do not. So we're talking about the high emitters within our own societies as well. That particular group need to make radical reductions in their levels of emissions. And for them, without a doubt, in the current way that we would measure our success within our society, they will not be having a win-win future. They will be seeing significant, what we would normally define as reductions in our material well-being. Now, at the same time as we see that, some of the poorer people in our societies, now I don't just mean in the poorer parts of the world, but indeed there as well, but also within Ireland or within the UK, some of those people, we need to see increases in their energy consumption, increases in their material well-being, and that their emissions will likely in the short term go up as they use more energy, which will likely be more fossil fuel energy. So for them, we expect to see an improvement in the quality of life, their material well-being, but that has to be compensated for by people like me and the other high emitters making even more deep reductions in our emissions. So on aggregate, what we will not be able to see is win-win and green growth, but when we break that up, that basically means it's the wealthy of us that are responsible for the lion's share of the emissions, and of course are responsible for the climate change we've already seen and that we've locked into the system. We will have to make significant changes to how we live our lives, and that will not be a green growth future for us.
I mean, the wealthy 1%, 5%, 10%, that group also has the closest access to political power, to economic power, to power within the business community. How exactly, and I appreciate this is a bit of a reach for a climate scientist, but how exactly do you tell the prosperous high emitters that the jig is up in terms of their lifestyle in the near future? Is it not the case they'd be quite happy to continue the wealth transfer upward rather than downward?
I think probably for some of them that's the case. But also, I mean, a lot of a lot of high-emitting people, like, you know, people around the world, the lion's share of people around the world are good people trying to live good lives, looking after their family, concerned about their local society and community. So I think we have to tap into that social conscience that we all have. You know, even the wealthiest people in society have that, at least some of them do.
Sure.
So we have to try and tap into that. It's not just about their future, it's about their children's future. And even, you know, many people also do actually have some degree of care and compassion for people elsewhere in the world. Now, it doesn't seem to me that we care that much about elsewhere in the world, but, you know, collectively we still want to try to ensure that our lifestyle does not impose too severe impacts on others elsewhere. So I think we have to sort of tap into that. It's not quite altruistic, but there's an element of altruistic concern that we all have, regardless of our income. We have to try and show where we can that there can be improvements in the quality of life for these particular groups, even if it's not necessarily their material well-being. We can also talk about it being a relatively short-term, a temporary change. Because once we've got low carbon energy supply in place, in theory at least, from a carbon perspective alone, we can go back to the levels of inequality that we have today. You know, I personally think that's a mistake, and I think there would be big problems from a broader sustainability sort of agenda. But from a carbon perspective, once you've got low carbon or zero carbon energy in place, we can consume as much energy as we want to do. The other thing for us as scientists, actually, in some respects, it's a little bit easier for us to communicate. As long as I'm not concerned about whether people like or dislike my conclusions, my only concern is do they agree or disagree with my conclusions. And that's really, I think, the only real role of academics and scientists is we do careful, robust research, and we communicate it vociferously and clearly. Now, whether people like or dislike our conclusions, to some extent, is irrelevant to us. It's whether they agree or disagree. So for scientists, it's much easier for me to turn around to the wealthier ones in our society and say, this is the level of reductions that you and people like you, and people like me included, would have to make if we are to hold to a 2°C framing. That may be unpopular, but as a scientist, I'm not interested. I'm not there for a popularity contest. That's the role of politicians. I'm there simply to provide information to the policymakers, to wider civil society, about the rates of change that we need to make in our current levels of emissions if we are to meet this 2°C framing of dangerous climate change.
Okay. You've taken an unusual, well, some would regard an unusual personal step, I think about 10, 11 years ago, that you decided to stop flying, which as an academic, a high-flying academic, if I might say, that must have been presented a lot of practical challenges. Why do you think that's important, or is it important?
I think it is important, and I don't think it's just the flying, but I tried to make some other changes to some areas of my life. But the reason that I probably flag up the flying is it's emblematic, firstly, of two things. Firstly, it's emblematic of what we see as progress. You know, the more we fly, the more we can, and we have, it's like a positional good. You know, I flew to the States 5 times last year for these important meetings. It adds not only to what we think is, you know, good about ourselves, but we think it reflects well for other people looking at us that we're this high flyer. There's something about that. That's attractive. So I think to actually try to unpick that, undermine it, to say we can still run good, successful careers without having to resort to these incredibly high carbon forms of transport. So I think it's important from an emblematic point of view. The emissions are relatively much less important. No doubt they all add up. If people like me and others stop making these, or start to make these changes, that's important from an emissions point of view, but most important is the message that we're showing or we're demonstrating to others, that you can live and work in an academic community, in my case, and have a good, successful career without having this enormously high carbon footprint. And what's also particularly important about aviation, unlike all other forms of transport, it's the one form of transport that it looks incredibly difficult to decarbonize. So when I decide to fly, I am sending a market signal to carry on building and expanding our airports, which is occurring, of course, everywhere, to buy more planes, which all of this is locking us up into very high carbon futures. Aviation within the UK represents about 7% of our emissions. Globally, it's about 2 to 3% depending how you measure it. Now, that's the emissions equivalent between the UK and Germany, just from aviation emissions, and it is growing much more rapidly than any country's emissions, with no prospect of us finding a low-carbon alternative. So when you put all of that together, you know, from technically, socially, symbolically, every facet of aviation is playing against the agenda to avoid dangerous climate change. And I think it's incumbent on those of us who work on climate change to demonstrate we think the issue is so important, the climate change issue is so important, we're prepared to make those sorts of changes. How on earth can we expect the people who are 32,000 feet beneath us to believe our message about making rapid changes and deep changes to their levels of emissions when those of us who are pulling the science together carry on with very high carbon footprints and lifestyles? So I think making the change adds credibility to our research, even though obviously it doesn't increase the quality of our research, but it adds credibility to the research.
Okay. You mentioned a little earlier about the reality of a 3 to 4C world further down the road. Some people say by 2100, I've heard projections more towards 2050, 2060 of that possibility if we continue on the business as usual pathway. What, in your opinion, would a 4-degree world look like, given that to many people, maybe here in Ireland, 4 degrees, an extra 4 degrees centigrade sounds kind of nice. So how concerned should we be about a 4 degree, a plus 4 degree centigrade world from where we are now, particularly in these quite compact timescales?
Yeah, well, firstly, looking at the timescales, Professor Richard Betts from the University of Exeter, and also involved in the Met Office in the UK, he has made the point repeatedly that if we are unlucky on climate sensitivity and we're sort of more at the upper end of it, we could be seeing 4 degrees C by around about 2060. Now, he's not saying that's likely, he's just saying that is a plausible scientific outcome of our current levels of emissions growth. The problem with 4 degrees C really is that, I mean, I often describe it as a different planet. It's not the planet we live on. That will bring about fundamental changes to every facet of our planet. It will change the ecosystems. We will destroy, well, even before that sort of temperature, we'll destroy all of the emblematic ecosystems that we can think of. You know, the Amazon rainforest will be significantly reduced and probably almost wiped out in any sense that we would recognize it today. We would wipe out things like the Barrier Reef. So all of those big ecosystems would go. But much more importantly than that, well, equally important to that, are the other sort of smaller things, like, for instance, the change in pollination insects. You know, the insects that provide our agriculture. Without those, you know, we are going to really struggle. 9 billion people having to self-pollinate all of our crops. You know, that becomes a challenge. You then start to think, well, what about the extremes? A 4 degrees C temperature rise, and remember, it's a global average, which is a very unhelpful way to describe these things. You know, we use 2 degrees C and 4 degrees C.
And it's land surface and sea surface.
And exactly, it's a global average. Yeah. Most of the planet is made up of oceans. The oceans have a high thermal mass. They take a lot longer to warm up. And therefore, a 4 degrees C global average is probably 5 to 5.5 degrees C on land. But even then, you say, well, what's the difference? What does that mean during extremes of weather? That means during the heat waves that we might see. So for instance, the 2003 heat wave in Europe, where 20 to 30,000 people died, you'd be adding about a 6 to 8 degrees C temperature signal on top of that heat wave. And of course, it could be prolonged. So you start to see, I mean, our systems, our infrastructures could not cope with that heat wave. But, you know, and I say a lot of people as a consequence died. You're adding a huge temperature signal on top of that. There's no way that our infrastructure across Europe could cope with those sorts of temperatures. We would be those sorts of extremes. But it's the same for flooding around the world. It's the same for droughts around the world. We would be changing fundamentally the weather patterns around the planet. That would affect food production, as the Met Office has pointed out previously, at 4 degrees C, perhaps a 40% reduction in some of the staple crop product from the southern latitude. At the same time, we're trying to get 9 billion people living on this planet. So, you know, everything from our material, physical infrastructure that we have constructed to allow us to lead good lives, that would be, you know, fall far short of what is necessary to deal with the weather extremes that will come along with a 4 degrees C temperature rise, right through to things like our food production, when you've got large populations desperate for food, issues of migration at very high levels would become hugely significant. And on top of all of that is layered a significant and fundamental, profound change, really, to the global ecosystems, to the way nature works on our planet today, all occurring really at the same sort of speed as when we were hit by a meteorite. It's really, from any geological or natural time frame, we are hitting the planet that fast, that hard, and consciously. You know, we know we are doing it. The meteorite didn't know the damage it was going to cause, but we know we're causing that damage, and we know that we can do something to avert it.
So, Kevin, in terms of how we manage the descent, whether it's the energy descent or the demand descent, there's different views, from carbon taxes to carbon rationing. Would you have a view as to how we can do this in a way that is fair, equitable, and achievable?
Well, the first thing I say here, I think we have to choose the approach that fits with our cultural framework. So I think if you're looking at a global level, I think you couldn't say we should only go down one particular route. I mean, some people have said we should have a global carbon tax. Well, tax is attractive in some parts of the world. It probably is much more acceptable if you went to Scandinavia. They don't have a problem with tax to the same extent that you would have in the UK or the US. So I think you have to really adjust the mechanisms to ones that sort of fit the cultural, social, and economic framing of your society. So if we were looking at the UK, which obviously I know reasonably well, I think there we would probably not want to see very large taxes. We would probably accept some levels of standards and regulations that would help drive down emissions, and maybe some taxes, but as long as they seem to be fair. So a lot of time people just still see taxes as something, it's government just taking the money and wasting and squandering it. Yet in Scandinavia, that's not the same view that they have towards taxation and government. So I think we have to colour those instruments that we would use in relation to our own economic framework. But nevertheless, I do think that it is too simplistic to think we can simply get away with a carbon tax, particularly when we just put a price on carbon and that will bring about the right level of carbon dioxide reduction, particularly from our energy system, but also from our agricultural system. And the reason I say that is because we need to bring the emissions down so rapidly that the carbon price will be so incredibly high. So some of the work that I and colleagues have done before, just looking at aviation, showed that we'd have to have a carbon tax of about 300 euros a tonne of carbon. At the moment, according to the emissions trading scheme in Europe, is about 7 euros a tonne. Yeah. So about 300 euros a tonne, and that would still only make 25% difference to the price of a flight. So if you were to fly from, I don't know if you can fly directly from Dublin to Rome, but if you can, imagine it's 100 euros, it would go up to 125 euros.
So now that tax will be completely ineffective against high earners.
Well, and people that fly, what's important here is that people that fly are generally higher earners. Mm. A few poorer people are flying once a year somewhere on holiday, but people who are driving aviation are almost across the board, the frequent flyers are those of us on much higher incomes. Mm. And we are inelastic to the price of energy. Mm. We looked at this in terms of shipping, and this work is still going on, that we have to go well above 1,000 euros a tonne to make any difference to the price of the goods that we would be bringing across from Asia and so forth.
So from 7 euros a tonne to over 1,000 euros a tonne.
Yes, for shipping. And the argument, of course, for carbon tax is that you apply the carbon tax across all sectors evenly. Mm. So that if you are really serious about bringing emissions down, you have to apply it so high. That would mean there'd be massive equity implications. Imagine you're the people who are already struggling to pay your energy bills in some of the 200 to 300,000 homes in Ireland that are in fuel poverty. And you suddenly find your bills have gone up dramatically because of a carbon tax. So your houses are now colder and damper. Your children get more bronchial problems. You have to visit the doctor more often. Now, the idea of a carbon tax that drives that sort of future, I think, is really regressive. So we have to find a way to say, how do you apply a mechanism that doesn't exacerbate the inequities that we already see in our society? So I think, therefore, a carbon tax in isolation and a simplistic carbon tax that lots of people are talking about is a real mistake. So I would rather see a regulatory framework that would drive this down, the standards and so forth.
I mean, are we talking then about carbon rationing on a per-person basis?
Well, I think that's one to seriously consider. I and some colleagues did some work on this quite a few years ago now, when we had a minister at DEFRA, David Miliband, that some of you over here might remember, and obviously Ed Miliband became the leader of the Labour Party, his brother. David Miliband was the minister at DEFRA, and he was in fact the architect in the UK for the Climate Change Act in 2008. And he liked the idea of the personal carbon allowance that myself and some colleagues were working on, liked it sufficiently well that he had passed it on to the economists in DEFRA to analyse, and they came back, and their broad conclusion was that it was a policy ahead of its time. Well, okay, that was 2008, we're now in 2016, perhaps we should be revisiting the idea of some sort of personal carbon allowance. One of the benefits of that sort of approach, if you're trying to bring very rapid reductions in our emissions that are necessary for our 2 degree C framing, is that it helps with the equity issues. It means the poorer people in our society would have, at least initially, would have plenty of carbon allowance to allow them to carry on their lives as they are. But better still, it means those people like myself, who would probably end up using more energy than my carbon allowance would permit, I would have to buy carbon effectively from them on the carbon market, which means I would be providing them with additional income. They would then spend some of that income on improving the amount of heating in their homes. That means their carbon emissions go up a little bit. Mm. But within the set carbon allowance, that means mine have to come down. And that means the wealthy people, unlike with a carbon tax, they have to drive the innovation process. And we know that the early adopters in society are the wealthy, the early adopters of new technology. It's the wealthy in our society that initially drive innovation. It's the wealthy that bought the very expensive mobile phones, microwaves, catalytic converted cars, hybrids. All of these things, when they first come out, are incredibly expensive. They are bought by people like me, the wealthy high emitters, driving innovation. The great thing about a carbon allowance would drive that innovation process and protect people who are in positions of poverty and suffering already with high fuel prices. So I think there are some very strong merits to a personal carbon allowance. We also looked in some detail about how could it be practically applied, and we felt it could be very practically applied with reasonable levels of ease within any sort of modern society. So we think if you're serious about large reductions in emissions, myself and a few colleagues felt this was a very serious instrument to consider and had lots of merits over and above a carbon tax. Now again, I think you have to go from country to country. Would it be appropriate in some countries and perhaps not in others? And there are certain issues you'd have to consider. But whatever instruments we talk about now for climate change, we are talking about very rapid reductions in carbon dioxide emissions.
And I think if we think back to the last use of ration cards, obviously during the Second World War in Britain, maybe a side effect of that was an increase in social solidarity in a time of crisis. And I mean, I think you'd probably agree with me that we are in a time of crisis now and that we need an increase in social solidarity, an increase in the sense that we're in it together. I think there is a concern among many people that if you take an action, whether it's in your own case giving up flying or some other action, that all you're doing is making more space for the free riders.
Yes, yeah. I mean, that's completely true, of course. I mean, ultimately, at the end of the day, you know, if I don't fly, then someone else can no doubt do that. Though I think the dynamic market signal is still important in that argument. Yeah, one of the things I think is really important about when we think about some sort of personal carbon approach is that everyone is engaged. It's not saying that the elite can be exempt from this, that all the high emitters have to be involved. So it's a little bit, it has the same sort of sense of solidarity that we did get with rationing previously. Now, one thing to think about, this word rationing puts a lot of people off, but whatever method we use, whether it's a carbon tax, whether it's a regulation, or whether it's a personal carbon allowance, we have to ration out the scarce resource of how much carbon-based energy we consume and can consume and how much carbon we can put in the atmosphere. That is a scarce resource. So whatever we do, rationing is inevitable. The thing about a carbon allowance card, it brings rationing directly to the fore. It's very clear. It keeps all of us involved. There's a level of fairness and there's a level of clarity to it that I think all of that helps engender wider acceptance and agreements within society than mechanisms whereby we very well know that some of the wealthy people will simply be able to pay that cost and not have to worry about the impacts. And so I think seeing us all in this together, you know, and there's something about that, all in this together, is something that would help engender a wider civil movement towards making significant reductions in our emissions.
And curiously, the whole notion of all in this together, it almost suggests that, if you like, a rowing back from the neoliberal there is no society model, because that's been the dominant economic and social model probably for the last 30 years. And it doesn't appear to have delivered increases in happiness. It certainly delivered increase in consumption, but it doesn't appear to have delivered increases in happiness, and it hasn't delivered increases in social solidarity or social well-being that by most measures. So maybe there is something to be said for it.
Well, certainly. I mean, I think certainly what we've seen with the neoliberal model, it has increased absolute levels of consumption well-being.
Yeah.
But the question then for society, I suppose, is firstly, where has that gone? To whom has it gone? And has it increased the sense of well-being of society? And I think there are serious questions to be had about that. And of course, that's not related just to climate change, and not by any means. We've got the Pope coming out and talking about these things. We've got Stiglitz, you know, and Piketty, two very eminent economists coming out and talking about these things. So we see many sort of world's leading thinkers coming out and actually saying that the neoliberal model has had its time, and perhaps it should never have been there in the sort of pervasive level that it was. And that's regardless of climate change. I actually think that once you layer climate change on top of a lot of the social problems that have gone alongside this particular model, then I think there's a very clear steer to move away from it as rapidly as possible. But in itself, of course, it has failed. I mean, people were better off materially up to 2008, and then if you look at Ireland and look at the UK, generally many of us now are only at that level, if not slightly below that level. So we've not seen, the wealthy have seen very significant increases and ongoing increases in their welfare, the material well-being. You know, the average person and the poor person certainly has not seen those increases. So the neoclassical model has not delivered on its own remit.
And also this time, perhaps for the first time, the middle class has also been abandoned. That's probably the difference in this phase of neoliberalism, that in previously you might say the poor and the working classes were abandoned, but it seems in this phase of neoliberalism that the middle classes have also been hollowed out.
I think that's true, and it's not just the middle classes in terms of the parents today. It's those parents looking at the prospects for their children, and that's I think to some extent that's even a bigger issue. You know, there are parents now looking at their children and think, my children will, I will be better off than my children will be. And in our modern sort of contemporary society, in post-industrial society, we have generally expected our children to be better off than we will. And this is probably the first generation within that society that is anticipating that their children may well not be better, as well off as we are. And again, if we layer climate change on top of that, I think it's very unlikely that their children will be anywhere near as well off as people like I and you have been.
And that's, we've talked about rationing, we've talked about the neoliberal system. To take a step back, we also have, if you like, a global climate fund now, which is supposed to be contributing or redistributing, if you like, between, at a governmental level, approximately $100 billion a year to help countries mitigate against and prepare for climate change. I gather you're not a fan.
Well, I'm not a fan of two things. First, I don't like, the language you use there, which is the language that's common use about redistribution. I see this as reparation. What we are doing, we have imposed on other parts of the world huge levels both of damage and of no access to the sorts of things that we have had, i.e. fossil fuels and energy, to overcome those problems and also to see the improved welfare in their society. So we owe them reparation. It is not aid. It is not redistribution. It is what we owe them because of the damage that we have imposed upon their societies and how can we've constrained their ways of resolving the problems that they are facing. So firstly, it's reparation. Second is, what is the sum of money? It is a crumb that's fallen off the table. $100 billion per annum. The subsidy, that's to all the poor parts of the world, both to adapt to climate change that we've imposed upon their societies and to help them reduce their emissions or not follow the same high carbon energy route and agricultural route that we have chosen to go down in the West. $100 billion per annum. The subsidy to fossil fuels in 2015, according to the International Monetary Fund, the IMF, which is, you know, not a left-wing think tank or an NGO, it's a very reputable, generally fairly conservative organisation. Their estimate is that the subsidy to fossil fuels in 2015, the direct and the indirect subsidies, that does include, and the health impacts of things like particulates in the atmosphere and how that affects, you know, health and bronchial issues, that the subsidy was $5.3 trillion. So forget the subsidies to renewables, forget the subsidies to nuclear. These are irrelevant relative to the subsidies that the globe has provided to the fossil fuel companies. 5.3 trillion.
So it's 50-fold.
53 times more than we're going to hand the poor parts of the world. Even the UK economy is 30 times more in a single year than the money we're going to give to the poorer parts of the world. And the real sad indictment to some extent to me of this is that not only is it a paltry sum, but then the sort of the clever bit is that we get ourselves to internally argue about, should it be 110, should it be 90, who should pay it? You know, we're arguing about the size of the crumb. You know, it's not billions, it's trillions that we owe through reparation to the poorer parts of the world. And we can see this, it's not even necessarily altruism, we can see it as self-interest. That if these parts of the world cannot deal with the climate change that we have imposed upon them, and, you know, let's be very clear that we are at an outside chance of a 2°C rise, and that will have devastating consequences for many of the poorer parts of the world, but where lots of people live, and in the globalized world we are not insulated from those people anymore. You may think you're on the far out on the west side of Europe, and we might often think that in the UK as well, but we are not insulated or isolated from the global community, from the impacts of increased food costs, from migration, from military tension. All of those things will play out at home in the UK, in Dublin, across all of Ireland. So we are not, in a globalised world, we are not going to be able to just think we can close our doors and put up the barriers and think we're protected from climate change.
Yeah, the Syrian conflict, some have described as one of the first climate change wars, if you like. And of course, we've seen a huge migration crisis affecting Europe in ways that we simply never predicted. That presumably, is that what you're talking about in terms of impacts? Because of course, Syria is just one country disintegrating.
Yes. Well, the first thing I would probably say is that I would be very cautious about saying it was triggered by climate change. But I do think it is fair to say there's some significant evidence, both in terms of Syria, but also previously in terms of Darfur, where we saw some terrible things happening there, that climate change was an exacerbating issue that was one of the catalysts that drove the sorts of changes that we've seen, or the disruption of that society in Syria. But I don't think it wasn't. I don't I think it would be unreasonable to say climate change was the thing that caused it. But that is the problem with climate change. It's always going to be layered on top of stressed communities that are already stressed anyway. So I think, but what we've seen there, again, is indicative of what we'll see elsewhere, when climate change will stress already stressed communities, and we'll see this sort of fragmentation and breakdown of society. Mm. And it's a relatively small country, Syria. And I think, just looking at Bangladesh, there are 30 billion people. 30 billion people, which is what you've got population of...
30 million.
Sorry, 30, my apologies there. There are 30 million people who live within 1 meter of sea level rise on the coastal strip of Bangladesh, 30 million. That's half the size of the UK, and your population here in Ireland is, what, 4.5 million? Mm. So, you know, 30 million people. Now, they are going to be hit by climate change, both by sea level rise, and they already are, of course, being hit by sea level rise, by increased severity of storms and typhoons, and likely by increased frequency of these events as well. That's going to affect their agricultural systems, it can affect their home, their infrastructure. They are going to be on the move, en masse.
Right. The US military, who, again, not a renowned left-wing organization, they have an interesting phrase they use to describe climate change. They describe it as a threat multiplier. And they see it as being something that exacerbates existing conflicts, existing tensions, existing resource crises. Maybe that's a more useful way of thinking about climate change. For example, what happened in Cumbria over the last few months, what happened in the Shannon region in Ireland, having a debate about was this one climate change, was it not?
Yeah.
In a climate-changed world, maybe what we really need to say is clearly the dice are being loaded. Would you accept that?
Oh, yeah, without a doubt. What we are seeing is a new normal.
Yes.
Any single event could be an extreme weather event. What we see when we see lots of extreme weather events, what we have is a new normal, and that's when we can see the climate signal. Though the frequency of these events occurring means that we are seeing climate change. Now there's some evidence to suggest that we're definitely seeing that now, and from the physics, from the basic science and the physics that we understand very well, and also from the modeling that goes alongside that, we expect to see, almost certainly, we're going to see ongoing increases in severity and frequency of these sorts of extreme weather events that are already percolating around the world. But in addition to that, of course, they are, as you say before, they are threat multipliers. Now, for the poorer parts of the world that are, well, the more vulnerable parts of the world, they're already stressed anyway, people are struggling to eke out a living or in these communities, this threat multiplier could very quickly catalyze significant, you know, disruption, dislocation, migration, military tensions, and so forth. But as you pointed out, we've already seen that in some of our own communities at home, where we live quite comfortable lives, and then we are suddenly hit by this thing the frequency of these things is having a very clear climate signal. We are going to be seeing these things more regularly. Now, any one event, as I said before, we can't attribute to climate change, but the increased frequency we certainly know is in line with what we expect. And so therefore, it's not as if it's just a threat multiplier on top of the other things that we face. We live comfortable lives, and then suddenly we're hit by this thing, which is extreme weather. And that extreme weather is causing us huge problems. So even societies that are fairly resilient and robust are really struggling with what when you think about it, we've only seen a 1 degree C temperature rise so far. And this is going to go on and on and on. In the warmest year on record, 2015, if we look since 2000, we have seen year after year after year of the warmest year on record. The carbon dioxide emissions now are higher than they have been for 800,000 years, three times longer than humans are on the planet. The carbon dioxide emissions this year will be 60% higher than they were in 1990. You know, every single measure that we use shows that we are moving towards a new planet, a different place to live. And unless we make radical changes to our emissions, then we are going to be, you know, passing on to our children, to the poor parts of the world, but even to those of us that will be here in 10 or 20 or 30 years, a radically different planet to live on.
We focused, understandably, Kevin, so far on one species. There's a few million other species as well. I thought we should give them a moment or two, just if we might. According to the World Wildlife Fund, the total number of wild animals in the world has declined by just over 50% in the last 40 years. Now that suggests that what's been described as the sixth extinction event is already in full flow. Mm. And I wonder, first of all, if you have any thoughts regarding that, considering these are our fellow creatures, both from the point of view of their right to exist in the world with alongside humans, but also as, if you like, as a cautionary tale for what goes around comes around.
Mm. Well, I think going with the second of those first, the cautionary tale, I think that we, as an academic who doesn't work on this particular area in detail, but I nevertheless think what we can see from this and talk with other colleagues is that this is indicative of the scale of change that we are seeing. And when I say that, it's the rate of change that's important. If these changes occurred across, 20 million years, 20,000 years, fine. These changes occurring, within the blink of an eye, I mean, within a handful of generations, we're seeing dramatic changes. Arguably, within a generation, we're seeing significant changes. So I think that what we're seeing globally here, within the sort of, let's call it the natural world, but I mean, really, that's partly the problem, but we have removed ourselves from the natural world when we are really part of it and completely reliant upon it. Without the natural world, we do not exist. So we are seeing these significant changes. All of the people that analyze this have significant concerns. I've not heard anyone that does not think that what we're seeing is very significant, and actually this raises really fundamental concerns for how we as a species are going to survive. I think seeing ourselves as separate has been part of the problem here. So from a science perspective, I think what we are seeing is as clear a warning as you should ever need, that we need to do something very differently and very rapidly. But the other part, going back to saying about their right to exist and so forth, I mean, this is a deeply sort of been a felt feeling for me as to why I partly engage in climate change. I mean, it has nothing to do with the science per se, that there's a beauty to our planet, in the way I see this. There's a beauty to our planet, not as a static sort of Victorian view of it that we can pin it out like butterfly wings on a plate and keep it in a museum or whatever it may be, but the dynamics, the beauty of the evolution of our planet, and what we have done, what we have done consciously and knowingly, is we have come in, as I said before, like the meteorite, and we are destroying that process overnight. And we think it's perfectly reasonable to do that, or at least it's not reasonable to not do it. We're not prepared to make the changes to avoid doing that when we have all of the information at our fingertips. So to destroy this place of absolute beauty that we don't know of anywhere else in the universe that is like this. And anyway, even if it did exist, there's still something much more entwined in being part of this beautiful system, which we are part of it, and we are a wonderful part of it. That we exist as a species is, in a sense, is a splendid outcome of the 3 years of 3 billion years of evolution that we've had on the planet, and that we have that arrogance now, when we can see all this around us, to think we can destroy not just ourselves but take the rest of it with us. From a sort of I don't mean this in any sort of any religious perspective at all, but from a sort of, and perhaps spiritual isn't even necessarily the right word, but there's something there. There's something in that dynamic beauty of our planet that makes me very concerned about issues of climate change, over and above the effects it will have on me, my communities, different parts of the world, and so forth. Over and above that, there's this deeper entrenched love, respect for the place that we live, the place that we have evolved, the place that has nurtured us as a species.
Yeah, I mean, it sounds, what you're describing sounds a lot like a moral framing of it, and also perhaps a moral reckoning.
Yes, I think that's a way to see it. But I mean, I almost think though we often use the word amoral or perhaps sometimes immoral, that all of the framings we have some framing of morality in it, but we may question people's different moral frameworks. But yes, without a doubt, I think we have to be careful here. There isn't a completely neutral approach to anything. Whatever framework we have has some moral dimension to it. So other people might turn around and say it's ridiculous to be talking about this sort of moral framework for these issues. But actually, by saying that, you already have a moral framework and an ethical framework. Right. Humans have moral and ethical frameworks, and that informs everything we do. It informs how we do our science and our physics. Mm. It informs every facet of our society. So we will never be, and can never be, and perhaps it's a very good thing we can never be like this. We can never be some sort of purely objective, atomized individual. That's not how living species, certainly the human species, has evolved.
To conclude, Kevin, what kind of a world do you see by the middle of this century, knowing what you know about, number one, the science, and number two, human nature and how we do our politics?
I think here it is a there's a probability answer here. you know, the chances are that we're going to carry on choosing to fail. And I'm careful about my language there. We are going to choose. We are choosing to fail. Mm. And we will likely carry on choosing to fail. We will make the right noises. And sometimes we will make the right noises for the right reasons, but with the wrong reasoning. And I say that word reasoning here because the issue about all of this is time. And actually the scientists have not been particularly helpful here, and that we have allowed this language of a certain emission reduction by 2050, or by 2030, by some period, you know, not in my term of office from a politician's point of view, or we're passing the problem onto the future generations to solve, we hope, with the technology. But actually climate change isn't about that. It's about this buildup of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere day in, day out. It is a timing issue. So we are choosing to fail. We are choosing to not take notice of our science. And even those of us who work on science are not being vociferous enough about the misuse of our science by policymakers and by wider civil society. So we're all in this sort of collective delusion together, and I include the scientists in this. So if we carry on along those lines, and at the moment, if you're a betting person, which I'm not, I think you'd say that's very likely that we will carry on with sort of, you know, rhetoric, the odd tap on the back after a successful COP and a paper agreement that doesn't bring about any action. And we'll carry on like this, and the temperature will keep changing, the world will keep changing. Initially it'll hit poor people, typically non-white, low emitters in the southern hemisphere. Then gradually that will affect food prices, it will affect wars, it will affect access to resources, and then eventually, far too late, we'll come along and think, well, actually, we should have done something about this. What can we do now? And our first response, as we're seeing with the migration issues, is that we'll put up the borders, we'll protect our own well-being, we'll think we're somehow more important than the rest of Europe, or the rest of our colleagues and partners around us. So we will break up and fragment any sense of union which we require, essentially require to address these issues. So that's, for those who've seen the film The Road, that's the road that we are on, and not one that I want to hand to my nieces and my nephews, not one I want to hand to the poor parts of the world, and not one that is in any way appropriate for the beauty of our planet that I was talking about earlier. But it's a probability issue, and there was a word of agency in there. We are likely to choose to fail. But we have an opportunity to choose to succeed. And the reason that people like myself, and I'm sure many of us, work on climate change, I mean, not some people just love working on climate change because it's interesting work in universities, running models, playing with the maths, looking at the science. But others of us are in there because we like all of that, but we also think it's a worthwhile subject area. Mm. And those of us that think of it like that, we are working this area because we want to instigate change along the lines of what society has told us it wants to deliver, i.e. avoid dangerous climate change, a safe climate within which we can all thrive and prosper, both with our species and other species as well. We are choosing to fail at the moment. We could choose to succeed. We know what we need to do. We have all the wherewithal intellectually, financially, in relation to resources, in terms of renewable energy. We have plenty of that around. We have the intellect and the labour skills to put this stuff in place. We can reduce our energy demand very rapidly without significantly changing the quality of our life, at least for the majority of us. And we can help the poor around the world. We know how to help the poor around the world. We can learn lessons from all around the world in a globalised world. We can see how other people have done things and where they've been successful and where they haven't been successful. We have everything at our fingertips to deliver a low carbon, a zero carbon from an energy perspective, and a very low carbon agriculture system that is in line with a prosperous, thriving society that has its appropriate role as part of this beautiful, dynamic, evolving planet in which we live. All of that is up for grabs. Just at the moment, we are running scared of changing the direction that we're heading, which is the complete polar opposite of that.
Kevin Anderson, thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Thanks, Kevin.